which is again a miscellaneous session. And I invite the chairpersons, Dr. Meena Gupta ma'am, Dr. K.K. Jindal, Jaideep, and Dr. Tariq Martin. All of them are here, and now I request them to take over this session. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Ma'am is here. Hello.
Yes, hello. Sir, we can hear you.
Yeah. The ma'am is there. Ma'am can start the session.
I'm not able to join.
Ma'am, you're already there with us. We can hear you.
Achha, good evening.
Good evening, ma'am.
Friends. And first of all, I wish to thank Dr. Achal and his team to ask me to be here. And good evening to my co-chair persons as well, Jaideep, Dr. Jindal, and Dr. Tariq.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, beta. I'll request the first speaker, Dr. Awadh, to deliver his talk on endovascular therapy in acute ischemic stroke.
So I thank you, the chairperson, Dr. Meena ma'am. Thank you so much for introducing me. And I also thank DNA to give me this opportunity to speak on endovascular therapies in acute ischemic stroke. This is a huge topic. I cannot finish in 13 minutes, but I will try to summarize. So if we see the last two decades of management of acute ischemic stroke, before 2015, the window was less than 4.5 hours. And beyond 2015, with newer trials, based mainly with large vessel occlusions, the window period has reached almost up to 24 hours with so many of the trials which has crowded this slide, mainly the recent Dawn and Diffuse, which brought the window up to 24 hours. So endovascular recanalization, that is mechanical thrombectomy, has become the predominant therapy of acute ischemic stroke. And it is... if we consider the epidemiology of large vessel occlusion, the initial trend of randomized control trials for thrombectomy considered LVOs mainly the intracranial ICA or M1 segment of MCA, but subsequently M2 MCA, A1 or A2 segments of ACA have also been included for mechanical thrombectomy. So overall, it constitutes almost 24 to 38% large vessel occlusions. If we go for thrombectomies, almost 3 to 22% of cases of acute ischemic stroke are potentially eligible for mechanical thrombectomy. And what are the important determinants for candidacy of mechanical thrombectomy? So I would cover mainly these five things which are important for the candidacy for mechanical thrombectomy. So current AHA/ASA guidelines, they recommend, they have class one evidence for patients must undergo thrombectomy who have pre-stroke MRS 0 to 2. They have causative occlusion of ICA or M1 segment of MCA, age more than 18 years, stroke severity NIHS score of more than 6, aspect CT aspect more than 6, and if the patient can be initiated on treatment within 6 hours. And the other segments of vessels, they have lower level of evidence. And also 6 to 16 hours patients, so if they are eligible, if they meet Dawn or Diffuse criteria, and selected cases up to 16 to 24 hours. And target for thrombectomy is a grading of angiographic modified thrombolysis in cerebral infarction, TICI grade 2B to 3. That should be the target of thrombectomy. So the time of onset, symptom onset, is it important? So these are the various trials which included almost patients up to 24 hours. So this was the meta-analysis which tested for time. If we see, this is a Hermes collaboration meta-analysis. We see if there is increase in time from symptom onset to reperfusion, the probability of good functional outcome is reducing. But if we see the Dawn and Diffuse trials, the late window patients had better functional outcomes. So up to 24 hours. So this is a paradox. Hermes says the early recanalization is good functional outcome, but Dawn and Diffuse yet had good outcome in delayed windows. So this late window paradox brought a concept of collateral circulation. So this is an important variable in selection of patient for thrombectomy. So here comes the importance of imaging in selection of patients for thrombectomy. Before going to collaterals, I would want to tell about the aspect score, which is important for case selection of mechanical thrombectomy. So this is an aspect score, which has 10 scores of MCA, depending on the area, and you subtract 1 point each with the, if they are involved. Good is maximum up to 10, and lower the score, it is bad. And there is a posterior circulation aspect also. So is it important? So this was a meta-analysis based for importance of aspect in patients to undergo thrombectomy. So they found the patients who have aspect score higher, that is more than 7, they have favorable odds of having good functional outcome. And also they have lesser, favoring lesser mortality and lesser chances of symptomatic intracerebral hemorrhage. They compared also aspect less than or equal to 4 or more than 4. So more than 4 also had a good functional outcome, but there was wide confidence interval. So next point is the collateral circulation. So another imaging criteria is collaterals. The collaterals are basically artery to artery anastomotic pathway, which are important in supplying for nutrients to the brain region, which has compromised blood supply because of the ischemia. So these collaterals are basically assessed by DSA, and in emergency situation, we have CT angiography and CT perfusion to assess these collaterals. And there are other methods by MRI, we can assess these collaterals. So this is a DSA-based collateral scoring system. And in this, various trials have included good collaterals, means at least filling up of more than 50% of the MCA pile circulation. So I have an example like this. The top shows a left MCA stroke with left M1 occlusion, and this shows a good collaterals. And another example where there is poor collaterals, left M1 occlusion. So importance of collaterals was seen in this meta-analysis, which shows if there are good collaterals, there is favorable functional outcome. If they, but they did, the good collaterals did not differ in outcome in various subgroups. And if there's good collaterals, there is lesser risk of hemorrhagic transformation unless the patients have received IV TPA. And also reduced mortality, good recanalization or reperfusion, and overall infarct volume is lesser. And this in collaterals depend on patient's age, metabolic syndrome, hyperuricemia, mean arterial pressure, and cerebral blood perfusion. So this is collaterals is an important predictor of outcome. Continuing with the imaging for endovascular thrombectomy, we know the increased window period in Dawn and Diffuse criteria also included few imaging more modalities to select the cases. The Dawn included the clinical deficit to infarct volume, and Diffuse take mainly took the penumbra and core mismatch. I will not go in detail of this mismatch, but at least we consider basis of cerebral blood volume, which represents the core, almost corroborating to the diffusion lesion, and MTT is mean transit time, which involves both core and penumbra. Penumbra is the reversible area. So mismatch is if we subtract the penumbra, we subtract the mean transit time volume minus the cerebral blood volume, we get the mismatch. And also we can calculate the mismatch ratio with that. For example, if this is the area which shows cerebral blood volume low, and this is a perfusion deficit, which is by mean transit time. So this patient has a mismatch. There is a big area of perfusion deficit, and this is the core. If we subtract, we will get the area of penumbra or reversible ischemia. Like this patient, there is no mismatch. So this is a complete infarcted area. For example, there is symmetrical blood flow, blood volume, and MTT. So this is a normal scan. In this case, we see large reduced blood flow, reduced blood volume, and large perfusion deficit. So there is no penumbra in this case. So patient will not undergo thrombectomy. And this is an example where there is a mismatch. This is the core and this is the MTT or the perfusion deficit area. So this patient has a scope of undergoing thrombectomy. Now, the another important part for patients to undergo thrombectomy is the location of the large vessels. So these are the various studies. And in M2 occlusions, there was a study which showed 69% recanalization rate and good clinical outcome in 59% patients. And they are mainly retrospective studies for M2 occlusion and distal vessel occlusion. So I will not go in detail. As far as stroke severity is concerned, these are the various NIHS score which have been considered in various trials. But the main point is patients who had more than NIHS 10, they favored mechanical thrombectomy. And the main cutoff considered in these all trials, they validated NIHS 6. So more than 6 NIHS was considered to be ideal for thrombectomy. But less than 6 is, it is still questionable to patients to undergo thrombectomy or not. Now there is a question of thrombectomy alone versus combination. So this meta-analysis shows overall there was no benefit in patients undergoing direct mechanical thrombectomy as far as good functional outcome was considered. And they also had higher fatal outcomes and they had no good reperfusion and also had more symptomatic ICH. So this required more randomized controlled trials to prove this fact. So recently two trials, that is direct MT trial, showed that direct thrombectomy was non-inferior to combination of thrombectomy with intravenous LTPS. Another trial recently published is DEVT, that also showed, this was a multicentric trial, that also showed primary outcome of endovascular thrombectomy being non-inferior to combined group. So we need, and long-term follow-up showed equal mortality in both the groups. So we need more randomized trials for direct thrombectomy to prove the superiority. As far as age is concerned, the Hermes collaboration showed patients more than 80 years showed good functional outcome who have undergone thrombectomy. So I would like to go on further. The tandem lesions in which there can be proximal occlusions, these are 10 to 20% of cases. Still, we have very limited evidence to intervene in these cases by simultaneous stenting with thrombectomy. As far as procedure, general principles of thrombectomy are concerned, their commonest approach is femoral artery, through the femoral artery, and the current second generation stent retrievers and catheter aspiration devices are used for mechanical thrombectomy, and the choices depend on the local expertise and availability. And in some cases, the combination of stent retriever and aspirations may be appropriate. There is level one evidence for stent retrievers, and for others, there is lower evidence of class 2B. There was a meta-analysis to compare these devices, mainly this stent retrievers and the aspiration devices. So this meta-analysis showed comparison with medical, the solitaire and Trevo devices, they did well as far as functional outcome is concerned. And Trevo did better than the Mercy as concerned with functional outcome. And as far as symptomatic ICH, solitaire has lesser chances of symptomatic ICH as compared to Mercy. And for catastrophic outcome also, the solitaire was favorable. And this is showing aspiration and stent retriever having good functional outcomes as compared to medical, but there was no difference in stent retriever and aspiration. No difference as regard to symptomatic ICH, but also catastrophic outcomes were less in retriever, but no difference in the two devices. So this is the COMPASS trial. I will finish up. This is a recent COMPASS trial which showed there was the aspiration first pass thrombectomy was non-inferior as compared to the stent retriever as first line therapy. So finally, we would like to say that sometimes these hybrid approaches, they have potentially better quality perfusion. This was in the COMPASS trial, which showed 55% reperfusion while 70% in cases of combination. So I will conclude, these are the combination methods. And we have recommendations of anesthetic technique, which should be individualized case-to-case basis for thrombectomy. There is no robust evidence for blood pressure, but at least 180 to 105 millimeter mercury should be maintained within 24 hours patient contemplated or have perfused with mechanical thrombectomy. Thank you.
Is there? We don't have much time for questions.
Yes.
We are running short of time. I'll ask my co-chair, Dr. Jindal, to take over.
So, thank you, ma'am. Now I request our next speaker, Dr. Bilet, to please give his talk on cognitive impairment in Alzheimer's disease. So, now over to Dr. Bilet.
Thank you so much, sir. I would like to thank the organizers for having me here today to give me this talk, cognitive impairment due to Alzheimer's, using some old skills, some new tools in diagnosis and treatment. So, every time when I get a talk like this, the first thing that happens is I don't know where to start. So the thought I had was, let's start with some history. So Alzheimer's was originally called in the first case report by Alois Alzheimer as a peculiar severe disease process of the cortex. So this was the psychiatrist in 1906 who saw this patient, Auguste Data, a 51-year-old woman with history of progressive sleep and memory disturbances, confusion, paranoia, and aggression. And then he followed this patient up, and once she expired, he autopsied her brain, and then he reported these distinctive amyloid plaques and neurofibrillary tangles. So this was the title of his case report, so peculiar severe disease process of the cerebral cortex. And that was the first diagnosis of Alzheimer's that was made. So beginning from that, I'd like to just briefly outline what I'll be talking about. So when I talk about old tools and old skills, I think it's more or less related to the clinical diagnosis that we have of MCI and dementia using all our clinical skills. Otherwise, the new things that are coming up in Alzheimer's especially is the role of biomarkers that's come up, role of genetics that has come up. And then a mixture of both old and new in therapeutics is what I'll definitely try to cover in this talk. So the first part of my talk will be the clinical diagnosis. So when a patient of any patient who comes with suspected memory loss or suspected behavioral changes and is suspecting dementia in that patient, so when he comes to the OPD, the first thing I do is everybody likes to classify what is the level of impairment, whether it's just a mild cognitive impairment, whether it's just a mild effect on daily activities, whether it's dementia or severe effect. Then you try to define the cognitive behavioral syndrome. So whether it's only memory loss, whether there's some executive dysfunction, whether there is some visual spatial dysfunction, whether there is some behavioral symptoms, etc. And then based on the syndrome that you've gotten, you try to etiologically see what could it be. Could it be Alzheimer's? Could it be frontotemporal? Could it be dementia with Lewy body? But my talk today focuses on Alzheimer's, so I'll just be focusing on that. So dementia, when it was when we had the 2011 update to the 1984 criteria for dementia, it defined dementia as any cognitive or behavioral symptoms which interfere with the ability to function at work or at usual activities, reporting a decline from previous levels of functioning, and are not explained by any delirium or major psychiatric disorder. And this should be proven by either history or that you've examined the patient on your own through various cognitive testing. Now, this cognitive impairment should have at least involvement of two domains. So one of them being memory, one of them could be memory, but it could also be not a memory, primarily a memory disorder, and it could also be executive dysfunction, visual spatial abilities, language dysfunctions, and personality behavior, which are the predominant phenotype. And the second cognitive impairment could be a minor phenotype. But any of these two should be present to classify that as a dementia. So when would you classify that dementia as probable Alzheimer's dementia? If that dementia has insidious onset with a clear-cut history of worsening of cognition, and then the syndrome fits into either one of the two classical presentations of Alzheimer's, so an amnestic presentation where memory impairment is the predominant problem, or a non-amnestic presentation where language presentations, visual spatial presentations, or executive dysfunctions are the primary problem. So once you've done that through your history and examination, you see and you begin to realize that I'm dealing a case with probable Alzheimer's dementia. Now, Alzheimer's, as we've now come to realize, is actually not a single disease. It's actually a spectrum, beginning from this preclinical phase where there are no symptoms, no cognitive testing will show any impairment, but the patient will have the Alzheimer's pathology, and that is the area of research that is going on right now. From that, going on to mild cognitive impairment, where there are many mild symptoms that do not interfere with everyday activities, and he's still independent in his ADLs. Whereas the spectrum of dementia begins with mild, moderate, and severe, where there is some, many, or interference with almost all everyday activities. So that is how Alzheimer's, the spectrum of Alzheimer's evolves. The 2018 criteria has mainly evolved into a more of a biomarker approach, but they define these stages of Alzheimer's dementia very well. But in the interest of time, I'll try to skip through it because it's mostly preclinical, mild cognitive impairment, and then mild, moderate, and severe dementia, as you know. So the patients come to us in the clinic. We've taken in history. We've gotten a brief idea that it looks like Alzheimer's disease. Now what to do? So we do some basic screening tests to confirm our diagnosis. So the two ones that I commonly use in our clinic is the MMSE or the MOOC and the MOCA. So the MMSE or a mini mental status examination with a standard cutoff of 24, but it's very subjective. So if it's a very educated college going individual, the cutoff can be as even a single point loss on the MMSE can be significant in that case. And then on MOCA, a score of 25-26, which is usually used at the cutoff. So MMSE, I don't think so I need to elaborate on this because almost all of us use this very frequently. This is the defined score range, but what is very important that for college graduates, even a single point loss in the MMSE can be significant. Similarly, okay. So the advantage of MMSE, what especially coming from a training center in GB Pant, it would be that patients who would not be able to use it in English, there is a standardized version in the Hindi language that's available, and it's been correlated well with the English version. So there are some questions. The Hindi version is available online, but if anybody wants, I can mail this part to them also. It has some changes which make it easier for somebody who does not understand English to undergo this test, and we can still use the cutoff criteria for MMSE. Well, the MOCA is a much more sensitive test. It's testing visual spatial functions, testing clock drawing, it's testing naming, memory, attention, language, abstract functions, recall, orientation. And so it becomes a much more sensitive marker of screening test. So that's why now it's getting more and more popular. And with the normal range of more than 26, but mild cognitive impairment, moderate cognitive impairment, severe cognitive impairment, criteria are also defined. So once that is done, you now will always screen these patients in a stepwise manner. So all patients without any atypical symptom, I think, will still get a thyroid profile, a vitamin B12, the routine blood test, some underlying markers of inflammation, and at least a CT, if not an MRI, unless there's some contraindication to MRIs, to get a basic imaging done to rule out other secondary causes. And then based on the clinical profile, if you have some suspicion for a secondary cause, you can go ahead and investigate them further through various tests. And then some very rapidly progressive cases or some atypical cases are when you start suspecting and getting EEGs done and the thyroid profile done and stuff. And so far, though, not available for routine purposes, but you can always confirm your atypical cases with these biomarkers, of which I'll be talking about later. So MRI, we've all commonly used for diagnosis of dementia. So showing mild atrophy on the MRI, especially in the hippocampal region, in the parietal, posterior parietal region. So that is what we come to commonly expect in a case of Alzheimer's. And you can use PET or the more easily available SPECT to see either hypometabolism or a decreased blood flow, as whichever the case of investigation might be, in your doubtful cases. But by and large, MRI is usually enough to diagnose these things. So that was the part of the clinical I was talking about. Now, very quickly, because of in interest of time, I'll be talking about what's new. So the world is now moving on to the biomarker diagnosis. So biomarkers are anything measurable in either the CSF or blood or through imaging, where we can get a confirmatory diagnosis of Alzheimer's in this case. So we have two sets of biomarkers that are available routinely now. So CSF biomarkers, of which reduced levels of amyloid beta in the CSF, increased levels of phosphorylated tau, which is a specific marker for AD, especially symptomatology. Amyloid beta may not correlate well with symptomatology, phosphorylated tau does. And also a marker of neurodegeneration, that is total tau, which is can be measured in the CSF. It's a non-specific marker. And then we have these imaging biomarkers, which are very specific. So you can directly image the amyloid deposition through PET, or you can image the tau deposition through PET. If you don't have, like we don't have this commonly available, we can use FDG PET just to see hypometabolism in which are parts of the brain, or even a simple MRI can actually demonstrate neurodegeneration or atrophy in these cases. Now, this is why I wanted to tell you about the biomarkers. Is through the 2018 update, now we've gone to a biomarker-based definition, although it's still, I feel, in more in the research purposes, but we've now gone on to more of the biomarker-based definition of Alzheimer's disease, wherein you classify amyloid pathology, tau pathology, and neurodegenerative pathology. Amyloid pathology markers are the amyloid PET or the low CSF A-beta 42 levels. Tau pathology markers are the high levels of CSF phosphorylated tau and the tau PET scan. And markers of neurodegeneration will be our traditional MRI or the FDG PET and CSF total tau levels. So based on what you have, you classify these patients as A plus A minus, T plus T minus, or N plus N minus. And all patients who are A plus, so amyloid marker plus, fall into now the Alzheimer's continuum. So they may or may not have tau pathology. They may or may not have neurodegenerative markers. But if you have an amyloid marker, which is the most specific marker, then that is a Alzheimer's continuum. It could only be pathological changes if the tau and neuronal markers are negative, or it could be the full-blown Alzheimer's disease if the tau and the neuronal degeneration markers are also present. And in cases which are A negative, that is the non-Alzheimer's disease pathological changes. So world over, we are moving to these levels so that you can, the purpose of getting these biomarkers then is if you have specific biomarkers, then you can intervene early in disease and you can find ways to intervene and treat the disease, which we so far have not been able to. So these are just examples of amyloid imaging. So amyloid PET, which shows a uniform deposition in contrast to a normal scan where gray matter is paired. This is the classical Harrison's diagram showing amyloid beta deposition. And this is the tau PET and the amyloid PET, which all shows increased levels in dementia. Now, a lot of new biomarkers are coming because CSF biomarkers sometimes is an invasive procedure. So they're trying to find biomarkers in the plasma, not been really successful. Beta secretase enzyme, neurofilament light chain, neurogranin, synaptic, all of these are now in the pipeline. The goal is just to make sure that we have some biomarker available. I will be running through my slides in the interest of time. So genetics, we know that only three presenilin-1, APP, and APP2, presenilin-2 are the real mutations which are associated with autosomal dominant Alzheimer's. But there is some genetic or heritability in about 60 to 80% of cases of Alzheimer's disease. In early onset, those are the three ones which are common. In late onset, it's only about the APOE4 allele, the genotype, which is associated with an increased risk of developing AD because of impaired clearance of the beta amyloid markers. Therapeutics-wise, unfortunately, there's not. I'll just take one more minute. Therapeutic-wise, unfortunately, we still do not have a lot of things. The most important thing is to simplify these patients' prescription, remove offending drugs, treat compensate comorbid conditions which can decompensate dementia. Cholinesterase inhibitors are still the backbone of treatment. Antipsychotics, we advise them to use judiciously, but we are actually using them quite because you get caregiver frustration is so common. Drugs like quetiapine are very commonly used in these patients. Vitamin E is the only food supplement which we have, which has proven some benefit. And then we must be treating these patients with offered all the comorbidities, depression, vascular risk factors, etc. as well as look at all the non-pharmacological interventions which can take place to minimize their risks to themselves and the society. As I said, all newer therapies are so far failing trials. So whether it is antibodies against amyloid beta or whether it is acid beta secretase inhibitors, all of them are failing trials. But hopefully there's some hope in the future that we can eventually go on to disease-modifying therapies in these patients. With that, I'd like to thank the organizers for having me here today.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Blake, for your nice presentation. So now may I request Dr. Jaideep Bansal to please share the next talk.
Dr. Vishnu is not going to present the case as speak because some mishap has happened in his family. His father-in-law has expired. So we'll move to the next topic, that is Dr. Rajiv Anand. I invite Dr. Rajiv Anand for presenting a case, a difficult to manage case of status epilepticus. Dr. Rajiv Anand.
Thank you, Jadeep. Thank you, Achal, and respectfully to Madam also. I hope people are still alert to this presentation, and I'll try to hurry up. I just have to show a case, so I'll skip most of the theoretical part about it. So this is, I think my screen is visible and I'm audible.
Yes, sir.
So this is the definition of status epilepticus. Only thing I have to say is, in practical terms, this 5-minute definition of convulsive status epilepticus means any patient who comes to me in emergency who is convulsing is status epilepticus. And why this new definition came T1 time is because by this time, I should alert myself to perform whatever I can do to stop this status epilepticus beyond 30 minutes. When there is a decompensation mechanism which starts harming the brain, and time is brain also applies to status epilepticus. When status epilepticus lasts for more than 24 hours, it becomes refractory status, super refractory status epilepticus, and 30 minutes to 24 hours is refractory status epilepticus. So we have patient coming with seizure, then status epilepticus up to 30 minutes, then refractory up to 30 to 24 hours, and super refractory after 24 hours. So why these terms are important? Because we should prevent the patient from going into refractory status epilepticus, as there will be more brain tissue damage. This is a patient which presented to another hospital with fever, altered sensorium, and status epilepticus. So we all suspect the patient of meningoencephalitis when this is the presenting symptom or presenting syndrome. And we do all the tests to find out the etiology. And at the same time, we cover up the patient with antipyogenic and antiviral drugs till the time we are able to specify the cause of this. So this patient's MRI was normal. The patient was suspected to be having HSV encephalitis and went into refractory status epilepticus. This patient was given almost every drug available for us to use, injection fosphenytoin, lacosamide, levetiracetam, injection valproate, magnesium sulfate. Then when patient doesn't respond to this, we give clobazam by Ryalstube. We also give other drugs which can be given by Ryalstube. I'll be elucidating them later. This patient was also given antibiotics and acyclovir. So patient was still throwing convulsion, and on day 4, patient was shifted to BL Kapoor Hospital. Earlier patient was in my preceding hospital, that was in Jaipur Golden. So it was diagnosed as super refractory status epilepticus. Patient was put on midazolam and propofol infusion. Levetiracetam was increased to maximum dose of 1 gram TDS. And we repeated an MRI, which shows these findings, and EEG, which shows continuous discharges, periodic, almost periodic discharges. So MRI brain has shown bilateral temporal lobe, hippocampi, T2, and flare hyperintensity. EEG showed bilateral continuous generalized epileptiform discharges with burst suppression. CSF routine and HSV PCR was negative. We also suspected autoimmune at this stage and did autoimmune profile, which was negative. Anti-TPO antibodies were negative. And other routine investigation, including microbiological parameters, were negative. So this patient continued to have non-convulsive status epilepticus with some myoclonus, twitching of eyelids and lips, and unconsciousness. Patient was in deep coma. So propofol infusion was started. So after 48 hours on day 6, she developed propofol infusion syndrome, characterized by hypertension, lactic acidosis, and hypertriglyceridemia. I'm highlighting this case because we did everything and we learned about the side effect of every possible drug which we use. She was switched over to thiopental and midazolam was continued. Electrographic seizure still continued. On day 8, oral through Rylstube, we gave topiramate, but still she had. And here, since my patient was not responding, we gave, considering autoimmune etiology, we gave methylprednisolone. But there was no response. So on day 12, I added IV phenobarbital in toxic dosage and continued it subsequently in toxic doses to achieve control, because this was the only drug left out of the armamentarium we have already used. So her seizure discharges, as you will see, have decreased, and her MRI changes also have improved with the improvement of seizure. And this is her EEG, which subsequently on third day of phenobarbital treatment. So we tapered thiopental, and on day 20, this patient was conscious, irritable. We started her on fentanyl infusion, and with fentanyl infusion, she developed fentanyl-induced movement disorder. So there were severe generalized choriform movements. We stopped fentanyl after 24 hours. We added haloperidol, but they did not respond, and we gave tetrabenazine. Through the progress of this case, we learned that what all we have to do and what all we can prepare ourselves to face when we are using these drugs. So on day 26, she was extubated, switched to oral drugs, gradually responsive, maintained well in ward, discharged in normal condition with intact cognition and seizure-free state. So this patient was labeled as new onset refractory epilepticus, status epilepticus syndrome. I'll not go into theoretical part of it, but summarizing, etiology is unknown. In this patient, status epilepticus lasted for 20 days. We did give steroids. These patients have autoimmune etiology in some of them, and they do respond to high dose of steroids or IVIG, but this patient responded to phenobarbital. We also learned that we should not forget our older anti-epileptic drugs. Sometimes the response may be good. In my experience, whenever I have confronted with something very serious, I have not left it without having used phenobarbital. Others are side effect of the drug. We learned fentanyl syndrome, induced movement disorder. We also learned other complication of propofol, and thiopental also caused in this patient hypotension and hepatitis, which I failed to mention since I am also in wanting to finish this. So we had faced almost everything. So only thing which I had in my mind was, should we try very high dose of phenobarbital before giving an anesthetic agent? My answer is yes. Can early immunotherapy help in refractory status epilepticus? In some patient, it does help. And whenever we give fentanyl and we have induced movement disorder, then we should try tetrabenazine also. So this is briefly, I'll summarize how we should proceed and what we did. So first 0 to 5 minutes, conventionally, we should focus on general factors, that is airways, breathing, and excess blood for blood chemistry and intravenous line, do clinical examination and ECG also. I'll tell you why ECG is very important. Besides talking about the side effect of the drugs we use, it is also important to differentiate and diagnose status epilepticus. I use lorazepam since the time we have been using. Midazolam is used by my colleague. Diazepam we are not using now. We can give lorazepam 4 milligram to an adult patient as a bolus and repeat another 4 milligram as soon as the patient comes. it is written that between 5 to 30 minutes, we call it established status. But however, practically, all of you will agree with me that as soon as we ask the sister to load lorazepam, we also ask them to load a anti-epileptic drug, which is one of the choice we make. Earlier, it was phenytoin as the commonest drug. I'll also show you what now is being used. But my point is, we must use all available IV anti-epileptic drug if my patient has not responded. Like, at least two drugs should be tried. The combination could be fosphenytoin, phenobarbital. Whereas only problem with phenobarbital is we should be in a hospital center where respiratory depression can be taken care of. All drugs have their advantages. Levetiracetam has become a very popular drug nowadays, and in some of the center or in a modern centers or in cities, it is being used more commonly. We use other drugs also like valparin, and there are trials available which say that they are equally effective. But as a neurologist, we should go into little more detail of history and recommend a drug which probably if patient has faltered, because one of the commonest cause of patient has missed the medication. So we can top up the same drug if it is available in intravenous form. 30 minutes, it becomes refractory because then failure of compensatory mechanism is there. So we have to have a critical care team, neurophysician and internist available. So it can be non-convulsive if the patient has not regained consciousness. So we should have a facility for EEG monitoring regularly, or we should be able to do an EEG. So the agents, as I told you, we have to put the patient on sedative or anesthetic doses of these drugs, which could be midazolam, propofol, pentobarbital. We used almost all of them in our patient. Oral drugs through rilstrup, clobazam, up to 40 milligram per day, topiramate, and nowadays we also use perampinel. So this is a, however, I also practically try to tell you that whatever we have, we should have a status epilepticus treatment chart available to our emergency staff everywhere. And that chart also, they should have those drugs available. So we should include in this chart those drugs which are available, say in ward, cart, or in emergency or in ICUs. Often we can theoretically talk that this should be given, but if that emergency, the drug is not available. So we have the onus of making a status epilepticus protocol, and we have the onus of making those drugs being available to the patient when needed. So then super practice status epilepticus, seizure persisting after 24 hours. So ketamine is another anesthetic agent which has come into vogue nowadays, because all anesthetic drugs depress the cardiac status, whereas it improves the cardiac. So it causes little increase in BP. So it can be combined with other drugs to offset the side effects of the drugs. So today, the neurologists are not leaving patients. So we have alternative treatment. Magnesium was already given in this treatment. This patient, immunotherapy was tried in form of methylprednisolone. We did not give immunoglobulin. Patient responded to phenobarbital at that stage. Ketogenic diet, DBS versus VNS surgery can be tried in certain patient. So this is a summary of drugs which we used in 100 patients, which my DNB student did a thesis about. So as you will say that commonest drug being used nowadays is 20 in 28 patient out of 6 is levetiracetam. Then second commonest is valproate. Then we also use phenytoin and lacosamide. So because patient doesn't tell you that he has status epilepticus. So careful that when patient has come, is it true status epilepticus? This is a patient which I saw when I was in Jaipur Golden Hospital. He used to come to our emergency with seizure as soon as he was better. But once he was admitted in ICU and my this in ECG before, he used to have seizure. So this patient was having ventricular fibrillation, then anoxia, and then seizure. Ultimately, this patient was put up a defibrillated device. So it's pseudo-pseudep. So if this patient was not diagnosed, then this would go into this stage and we will think that status epilepticus has become refractory. So this is a true case I am presenting, whether it is a failure of us to have recognized, but I want all of us to be aware. This is a patient which contacted me 3 days back. Not 3 days back, last week, an old lady of 65 years old. So I sent an EEG technician at their residence. So I asked them, I need three investigations. She was getting recurrent episode where the family would say that she becomes absent, no past history of seizure. So I said, I'll send a Holter monitoring and 24-hour BP monitoring, whether it was hypertension. So I asked the EEG technician to go home and do an EEG. So he did this EEG and this was the discharge. So I thought, Eureka, I have found it. And patient, after seeing this EEG, they went to BLK emergency. Unfortunately, her COVID antigen was positive and she was shifted to COVID ICU, where I did not go. But this is what her ECG was. So we can be foxed in today's era, even if the EEG is showing this. So I thought that this is a non-convulsive status going on. Actually, she was into a subacute hypoxia sort of thing where the brain was also having epileptic discharge. So what was to be treated was more important than what I presented as status epilepticus, but that is how we should be able to help our patient with whatever problem they come. And this is what Corona has does to us. So this is what it is. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It was actually really, I do agree with you. There are small things which are there in the practice, but we are forgetting. The phenobarbital is a wonderful drug in cases where the other drugs are not effective. And it is a time-tested drug in a short period when status epilepticus is there. There's no harm in giving it when other drugs are not acting. Thank you very much, sir. And I congratulate Dr. Achal for organizing such a nice DNA con and having the good scientific intent. Thank you.
Okay. Good morning. Okay. All right, ma'am. Thank you. So we have come to the end of the session now. And I would like to thank the chairpersons, Ma'am Meena Gupta.
Thank you.
And
now it is on, madam.
So it has been a very nice session. And I also thank the speakers, Dr. Awad, Dr. Abhilek, and Dr. Rajiv Anand. And unfortunately, Dr. Vishnu could not come. His father-in-law expired 2 days back. So we close this session now. Thank you and good night.
Thank you. See you all tomorrow again.
Good night. With another set of lectures at 3:30 p.m. Sorry. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Good night.
Good night.
Nice case.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, ma'am.